Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Sanctuary Wildlife Awards 2016. Yes, you may clap. It's a very special evening indeed. My name is Dia Mirza, and I stand before you in my capacity as a member of the governing board of the Sanctuary Nature Foundation. Sanctuary's vibrant new avatar. I'm delighted to be alive on a planet thrumming with exquisite biodiversity, a fraction of which you just saw. And I am delighted to be your host this evening. And we can put our mobile phones off. Please, thank you. I doubt that there was ever a time in human history when any species, leave alone Homo sapiens, was free from trouble, strife, and the trials of life. And yet, life continues to find a way to survive, to thrive. Somewhere in this hall, a spider searches for prey. On the roof, kites and crows await dawn so they can go about their task of keeping our city clean. Mumbai shorelines are studded with seagulls that fly in from the high Himalayas. Tiny warblers from Kashmir's Dachigam flit about in the Parsi Panchayat's green haven on Malabar Hill. And in the newly declared Thane Creek Flamingo Sanctuary, like a living scarf of pink chiffon, over 30,000 flamingos and 2 million waders have arrived to brighten our lives. Humans are just one slender thread in this vast tapestry of life on Earth. Albeit with the power to either enhance or unravel the entire thing. For all the bad news we are force-fed each day, the truth is, it is an astonishing and absolutely wonderful world. Celebrating that one simple magical reality is what the annual Sanctuary Wildlife Awards evening is all about. And to remind us why it's vital we keep this wonderful world wonderful, may I ask the editor of Sanctuary Asia, founder of Kids for Tigers, and now our guiding light of the Sanctuary Nature Foundation to come up on stage, my hero, and share purpose with two.
Oh my good Lord. Yeah. Look. Thank you so much. You're magnificent. How can we possibly lose? We can't lose. We've got phenomenal people in this room. We've got nature on our side, and Dia, you strengthen me. You seriously strengthen me by validating that we're on the winning side, on nature's side. You know, something like 2 decades ago at a Rotary Club meeting, I found myself amazed. I was sharing a table. The meeting started late, not normal for the Rotary, but started late, with the Dalai Lama sitting down there for 10 minutes or so, just me and him talking. And of course, we spoke about the problems of the world and what was happening to Tibet and tiger bones and what was happening here and the falling standards of human values across the world. And, you know, despite everything, he said to me that, look, just understand that the best things in life are still free. We have got to give thanks for that. And it was over. And then suddenly the gong went and the meeting was called to order, and I felt a small tap on my shoulder, and His Holiness said to me, remember, whatever life's problems, whatever miseries you see around you, it's your duty to be happy every single day of your life. That's the gift of life we were given. It's our duty to be happy no matter what life throws at us. And that advice has stood me in very good stead. As the evening unfolds, you will be reminded, you know, that this river, that wild creature, pristine forest, something, some breathtaking vista will be stolen, be destroyed, vanished into oblivion. Don't let that take anything away from the blindingly beautiful truth that it is indeed a wonderful world. This is the single most important truth that the Sanctuary Nature Foundation was set up to convey to the young people to whom we'll be passing on a green baton tomorrow. And with that, what I'd like to do is I want to acknowledge one thing. We could do nothing without our friends. We could do nothing without our friends. And right now, I have two very, very dear friends in this hall with us. They also happen to be our sponsors, but that's a coincidence. Himendra Kothari. Chairman, DSP BlackRock. And Ravneet Gill, I've known you for 30 years, Ravneet. Now you're the CEO of Deutsche Bank. Thank you. I just want to reiterate that everything that was Sanctuary Asia is still Sanctuary Asia. Just now is the Sanctuary Nature Foundation. It's part of that seamlessly. Well, people ask why. Why suddenly a nature foundation after 36 years? Well, the question most asked of me and Sanctuary by virtually every friend or supporter has been that, you know, you've opened windows for us to see the real world, but what precisely is it that we can do? What can I do, really do, not just naam ke vaste? And up to this point, Sanctuary, frankly, has never accepted a donation, not one. Goodwill, ads, subscriptions, all kinds of things, yes, but not a donation. And we were a small team, we still are right now a small team, I think we'll grow. But up to this point, there were limited ways in which our small team could directly engage with people. That sort of now changes. I sat with my wife Madhu tirelessly for all these many years, 47 years yesterday, day before yesterday, our anniversary. Frankly, I don't know where you are, Pap, so you deserve a medal for sticking around with this guy for 47 years. Woo. Well, Madhu, Miel, my daughters, Miel and Tara and I, we sat together and chose to turn Sanctuary over to India. There were many offers to buy and things like this. This was never why we started the magazine. In the shape and form of the Sanctuary Nature Foundation, which we envisage actually as what it is, a Grand Central Station. But we make no trains and we run no trains. All we do is to direct people to each other so that they themselves leverage each other, like the corporate world sometimes does, and do good for nature. So if we are able to do that, I think collectively, all of us here, we will be able to reach safe harbor no matter what the problems thrown at us are. So friends, may I please welcome on stage Mr. Himendra Kothari, who's also the founder chairman of the incredible Wildlife Conservation Trust. Himendra, please. There.
Good evening, friends. My friend Bittu, my fellow wildlifers, earth heroes, and today we are very fortunate to have with us Lord Nixon. Who has told us 10 years back also, we are going through a serious global warming. And we are so happy that he's here. Maybe I hope we have a chance that he will say some few words to us today. But on behalf of Deutsche Bank and DSP BlackRock, I'm glad to see so many people here today. It shows the love of wildlife and conservation is still there. And hope all of us together will try to see our forest through wildlife. We are in a position to save and save where we are able to get water for the cities like Bombay, without that, where we are near, close to crisis, which I was talking to Lord Stern, that we are close to crisis which we don't realize. Also want to thank today Joubert family. Derek and Beverly are here, the topmost filmmakers in the world of wildlife, and also trying to see, why don't you, all three of you get up so people can see you. Lord Stern, where are you? Yeah, please let people see you there. Please, all Beverly. He has preached, in fact, all his life to try to take the film. Not only that, but he has today started conservation. It is by ecotourism, what we call here, is a way he's going forward in Africa. Hope he'll bring in India some of his what experience over here. And I'm very happy that he's agreed to join Wildlife Conservation Trust Advisory Board also. So I'm very happy on that. Ravneet and we, both of us, are very fortunate, Bittu, that you have taken us here. In fact, as a sponsor-wise, I'm sure more corporates will be very happy to do the same. I just want to say and congratulate all the heroes today. And today you'll recognize them. But I'm sure there are more thousands of them here in India. We hope we'll be able to find them and recognize them, so that we can try to fight the global warming. Thank you.
Himendra, 1 minute. 1 minute. Don't go away. I have an announcement to make. This man has been giving away money for direct protection of wildlife for I don't know how long. I personally think that in terms of direct wildlife protection, Himendra, you, Anish, your Wildlife Conservation Trust, is probably the single largest donor outside of government for direct wildlife protection right now. Now, there's no way I could do or your friends could do anything that competes with what you do, Himendra. That's a basic truth, you know. But what we did was, I have a very dear friend called Amit Chandra, and we were sitting together one day, and it was Himendra's birthday, and we said, look, what can you give a man like Himendra Kothari? So he just turned up and said, why don't we do one? He keeps giving money to everybody else. Why don't we start a Himendra Kothari Tiger Defender Fund? So first I thought, WCT, Tiger Defender Fund? And he said, no. Whatever it was, we pulled in, we got 8 lakhs of rupees and we put it inside that. Then quietly we phoned a few of his friends and said, this is what we are doing. And suddenly Himendra, forget about the 15 crores, 25 crores you spent, but we've got 15 lakhs and we'll give that away to individual small mud on the boots guys in your name. Thank you very much, Himendra. Thank you. Thank you.
I wish you had not kept it my name, but anyway, thank you.
Well.
Ravneet, we go back 30 years, you know. It's, what shall I say to you? Well, I would like you to come up over here. Ravneet is a wildlifer. He's one of the finest friends you could ever hope to ask for. He's also the CEO of Deutsche Bank. Please, Ravneet, may I ask you to come out and address us?
Thank you, Bittu. Lord Stern, award winners, distinguished guests. As always, delighted to have each one of you here for such a special evening, which the way I look at it is really the nature's Oscar, not just for India, but globally. You know, as a banker in these days, it's so refreshing to stand before a crowd and not talk about demonetization. But having said that, it's helped as well. I mean, earlier, you know, I used to come and stand before such a large audience only once a year at the Sanctuary Awards. Now I just need to go and stand in front of any of my ATMs, and it's a bigger crowd. So I think it just helps get over stage fright. Bittu talked about a 30 years friendship. I think if there was ever the Energizer Bunny, I think that's Bittu. Over the last 30 years, I think I've just seen his energy levels go up all the time. And Bittu, sometimes I wonder if it has something to do with the fact that every single day you get to kiss at least 150 women.
Oh, Lord.
But you know, much as we talk about our ATMs, all I'd like you to do is picture the fact that, you know, it's not an ATM. It could be a tube well, it could be a well, it could be a tap. And, you know, just like the ATMs have run dry, these taps and these tube wells have run dry as well. I mean, just try and imagine a situation like that, and where nobody has the ability, the power, or the authority to remonetize it. For some reason, when we think in terms, and when we talk about sustainability, there is a certain distance with which we look at sustainability. We think that sustainability is what happens in Marathwada, what happens in Telangana, in parts of Chhattisgarh, etc., but that it doesn't happen here. But the fact of the matter is that, you know, nature and ecology don't recognize geographical boundaries, they don't recognize artificial boundaries, and you know, sooner or later, we'll be directly impacted as well if we aren't already. And when I look around and I see what happened to Delhi some time back, I was surprised that, you know, that did not generate the kind of debate that, for instance, demonetization has. And think about it, that, you know, we can think that Delhi is 1,400 kilometers away and we are safe in Mumbai. The other day I was talking to Praveen, and Praveen mentioned to me that the waters around the coastline of Mumbai have a fecal content which is 3,000 times what it normally should be. So just think about it. So I think these are issues which are very real, which are very immediate. They are not into the future and they are not far removed from us. They are very much a part of our day-to-day lives, the city that we live in, the homes that we stay in. And sometimes I think it's a little disconcerting that, you know, we don't deal with these issues, don't talk about them with the sense of urgency that we effectively need to. So again, I think between 17 years, you've, you know, been a torchbearer around all these issues. And I think the level of awareness that it has created, I still remember the 30 years back when we first met and you know, seeing, hearing you talk about things which were so alien at that point in time. I think the awareness levels have gone up significantly. But the point really is that, you know, becoming aware is only part of the process. Think about it. I mean, when we talk about fitness, so we all know that fitness is good for us, but the mere recognition that fitness is good for us doesn't make us fit. You still need to work for it. Right. You know, put in the hard yards, you know, sweat it out. And is India sweating it out, you know, the way it should be to try and get its house in order? And Lord Stern, when he speaks, will tell you about, you know, what the consequences could potentially be. I mean, that his seminal document is known as the Stern Review, not just because it carries his name, but it also carries a very stern message. and for all of us to take a note of. So, but I do feel, Bittu, that with people like you who tirelessly go about this, the wonderful work that so many of our award winners over here are doing, you know, will be a huge inspiration for many of our people. When we talk about our demographic dividend, I think one of the big things about demographic dividend is the fact that we have so many young people. And many of these lifestyle changes that we need have so much to do with mindset. And we just believe that, you know, as India gets younger, I think that mindset is more flexible, it'll change a lot faster. And we will be able to rein things in, get our house back in order before, you know, it is too late. All that I'll end with is a quote that I read some time back. And they said that the single biggest threat to our planet is the belief that somebody else will save it.
Absolutely.
Ladies and gentlemen, you and I have to save it. So let's not waste any further time. Thank you very much.
It's a visual feast. Really, what you got in store for you right now is a visual feast. We plowed through over 5,000 wildlife photography contest entries. Birds, mammals, insects, fish, reptiles, amphibians from across Asia, they found themselves represented on pixels, you know, on our servers. And a team, it was led by Professor Parvesh Pandya, assisted by Gaurav Shirodkar, Purva Variyar, and actually the whole office, you know, we spent weeks and weeks and weeks, and we whittled down 5,000 to 100. There were many tears shed. No, there's one. Anyway, our jury eventually evaluated these completely blind. The jury had no idea whose picture, it was only the picture speaking for themselves. And this jury included the founder of Kolkata Birds, that's Sumit Sen. We had a National Geographic photographer, very, very dear friend also, Steve Winter. We had Sanctuary's image consultant. He happens to also have been this year the BBC Wildlife Photographer of the Year, Nayan Karnolkar. And, you know, I mean, we also had Lakshmi Raman, who sits in Boston and was sitting there on Skype all hours and saying, you're going to keep me awake, you're still going to keep me awake. We sort of went around the world. And we, after boisterous debate, a few tears, we came to a selection. Parvesh, shall we start with the special mentions? Forest phantasm. Look at that creature. I mean, I've never seen one. And now I see these Kabini pictures coming out and I keep saying, I'm going to Kabini today. But look at this. You can see the photographer, he had just about 6 or 7 seconds to take that picture. As that animal came down, Anish, you can see the scrape of its claws and the wood still flying. And I mean, this guy, Mainak Ray, I mean, I don't know. I'm a photographer. I mean, I'm supposed to be an editor of a magazine. I'll never be able to take pictures of the kind that we're showing out over here, you know. He used a high ISO in exchange for a fast shutter speed to capture the action, and what lends the image its slightly unsheathed. This thing is the claws, it's the eyes pinned to the camera, the magnetism of this creature, this arresting frame. I could go on and on. I've got lots more to talk to you about, though. Just look at that. Now, Sai V. Burke, River Cleek. These gentle waves, the waters of the Chambal River seem to sprout into 100 heads of silvery fish emerge in synchrony in the National Chambal Sanctuary. At the point where tourist boats go gharial spotting, these little fish rule the shallows. Normally placid, the disturbance is called by the boatmen as their crafts draw in and out and send them into a frenzy and what looks like this beautiful, delicate thing. Pretty ignored creatures. Good picture. Naresh Singh took something that we call the Rani of Rajbera, you know. If fear isn't apparent in the whites of this Sambar's eye, then it's certainly explicit in its desperate stance. Bandhavgarh's Rajbera tigress has 4 cubs to feed. She's not letting dinner get away, I can assure you. This display of unadulterated power of a full-grown tiger, frankly, it cannot but provoke awe, you know. In this case, even though the Sambar is more visible, the massive grasping claw of the tiger dominates the frame. Naturalist Naresh Singh says it took more than 20 minutes for the cat to subdue the deer. And when she successfully did that, the cubs arrived. Wonderful. Gossamer Siblings by Jayesh Joshi. You know, there isn't a single creature on earth that doesn't have a very specific purpose, and there is not a single creature on earth that wastes anything other than Homo sapiens. We're the only animals who have that fantastic technology. Look at these creatures. This is new life bursting forth on the site of a... Anish, I'll never pronounce it right. Bahunia Resmosa? Is that right? Somewhere. Resimosa. Okay, fine. Anish is my... This was taken in the Wansda National Park. I wish the Maharaja Wansda was here right now because people go there to see his leopards. But look at this, like filaments of silk, they shot across the frame. Newborns seem to be suspended in a corner, infinitesimal. But their legs stand out in detail with warm tones and sharp lines. Jayesh Joshi brought these little guys surely into the limelight. And Ripon Biswas, Seeing Red. On the floor of the Baksa Tiger Reserve, a red weaver ant staged one last act of rebellion against a predator many times its size. Before it being dismembered and by the sniping mandibles of a tiger beetle, it bit into the large insect's leg and continued to hold on even as it was dead, you know. This picture by Ripon Biswas is a vivid reminder of the seldom documented small-scale dramas that go on underfoot. When you go into a forest, don't just look for the tiger and the elephant. Look a little closer, might be just behind your bungalow, you'll find wonderful things happening. In the Nilgiris forest, you know, of Tamil Nadu, see 3 elephants. When you think of the largest land mammal on earth being dwarfed, you begin to understand the spaces that elephants need. It's not enough for an elephant to have a large football field. You know, it needs about 1,000 football fields. It needs much larger spaces. And you get photographers like Santosh Kumar, you know, who originally went there to photograph birds and was so taken by the dexterity of these elephants. I mean, if one of them fell, actually it's a really major fall, but they are very, very sure-footed. So he said that they look more like goats. He said, first I thought there must be goats over there. And then he looked through the glasses and he saw these. It's unusual to see them at such steep slopes, high altitudes, but in the Western Ghats, believe me, such magic does indeed happen. Mihir Mahajan came back with a picture that I think even Dr. George Schala, my dearest, dearest, most wonderful friend, would give his eye teeth to have taken. It's a lover's spat. On a steep ridge in the frosty mountains of the famous Hemis National Park in Ladakh, a pair of courting snow leopards interrupts their lovemaking in favor of a quick brawl. Sounds familiar? Usually clicked in furtive or shy repose that makes them seem inordinately benign, this image serves as a reminder that snow leopards lack neither fury nor strength. Mihir Mahajan trekked in this inhospitable landscape for 3 hours to reach the spot from where he could make this image. Amazing image. I have to tell you that we've got, you know, it's one thing to say photography, photography, but the camera and a good photographer is no less than a forest guard or the chief wildlife warden or the chief minister who wants to save something. Because the fact of the matter is that that camera, conservation photography, is real. People who will not go into that forest will be moved by pictures like these. That's an interesting, if not very appealing, some people suggest is not very appealing. I think it's very appealing. Anish, you want to come to my help again? Nikti Bratrakas Sancti Palur. What, how do you pronounce it?
Nikti
Bratrakas. Nikti Bratrakas, okay, good. Or the sacred swamp wrinkled frog. It's as droll in name as it looks. Endemic to the fast-flowing streams of the Western Ghats, this amphibian was rediscovered by Sanctuary Award winner S.D. Biju in 2011 after a 91-year absence from records. This photograph was taken by two phenomenal guys, Shashank Dalvi and Prasanjit Yadav, committed conservationist biologists that chose this spot in Coorg, Karnataka, based on 3 years of field work in the area and then waited 3 days for the frog to just jump onto this particular spot, and they got this frog with its habitat. Sabri Janki, Sky Ninja. This is the Chinar Wildlife Sanctuary in Kerala. An Indian giant flying squirrel sweeps across a cobalt sky, powdered with... Now somebody else tell me what this is. Altocumulus? Where are you, Parvesh? Altocumulus clouds. I wish I knew clouds. I don't know clouds. I don't know. But I've only edited sanctuary for 36 years. I know so damn little. Anyway, limbs hyperextended, its wing membrane stretches thin and translucent, making its blood vessels visible. If you zoomed in, really zoomed in on that, a particularly resident creature, it occupies tree canopies and roosts in hollows, where it makes a little cozy little home with bits of bark, tufts of fur, carpets of moss, soft leaves. It's nocturnal by nature, but it's rare to see it in the daytime, but this one was caught, boasting its evolutionary advantage on a sunny June afternoon. It's very special in our books, I'll tell you that. Indraneel Basu Malik. This one was my choice. You know, I told all these guys, I said, you take all the pictures you want. One picture is mine. So this is the editor's choice. It's incredible how a camera in the hands of an expert can turn into both a scientific and a conservation tool. This image of a purposefully slow-moving snail was shot in Mathiran by Indraneel Basu Malik. He used a slow shutter speed. Urvi, this is interesting. He uses a slow shutter speed and of 15 seconds, during which he fired 3 flashes from different angles to get this thing, and it shows you how it's beautiful in its simplicity and brilliant in its execution. The 4 delicate translucent antennae on the head are not feelers. They are his visual, olfactory, and sensory appendages. Nature gives every creature a way to survive. And some creatures Satyendra Kumar Tiwari lives in Bandhavgarh and some creatures don't survive. This is an electric fate. We got so many pictures, so many pictures. Conservation photography is coming of age. We got so many pictures of people who said, the call of the wild, this is what it is. Put your face in there. Don't look away. Look at this. This is what's happening. If you don't look at it, you're not going to solve it, you know. So this is big cat collateral, if you will. The tiger to whom the skin belonged was not the intended target of the high voltage wires that villagers of the Majgavan in Madhya Pradesh, they strung across the field. All they were interested in was wild pig or deer, which is bad enough. But when they discovered the electrocuted cat, an opportunity to make some money presented itself. They skinned the cat, put its pelt into a cement sack from which it was seized by the forest department that has an endless job. Endless job. Underpaid, underappreciated, overworked. This is my forest department. They should be at par with the Army, Navy, Air Force and Coast Guard. They are our dharti rakshak. These are the guys who are actually protecting. You know, these accidental killings, people say, oh, gareeb hai, ye hai, wo hai. Main manta hoon gareeb hai, yaar. But this is now feeding into the trade, the wildlife trade, which is the third largest illegal trade in the world after arms and narcotics. It's actually using these people now to say, why do you want to eat this? You give us this much more, you can buy 10 times more food. This is called silver lining. It's a special conservation mention. We've got 5 pictures that we chose for conservation mentions. Mendis Vikar. Vikarama Singhi. Today I've got very difficult words to pronounce. Lovely man, terrific photographer. This is a pangolin. Hunted for its meat, persecuted for its scales. It's currently considered the world's most trafficked animal. So little is known. At the 17th Conference of the Parties to CITES, the Convention on International Trade in Endangered Species, held in Johannesburg very recently, I was there, all 8 subspecies were uplisted to Appendix 1. With this, a complete ban on the trade takes place. This particular Indian pangolin was spotted by Mendes as it crossed the road in Rana in Sri Lanka, captured in sublime silhouette, lit by the headlights of a car. The image presents a somber but stunning portrait of a species on the brink, not only because it's poached, but also it could just get run over. So our roads need to go around. We bypass Muradabad and we bypass Sultanpur. Why can't we bypass a forest? I mean, anyway, no. Still not there. There's another thing. Jocelyn Santosatan. We call it the tip of the reef. Armed with a scythe, an Indonesian fisherman rapidly divests rows of landed sharks off their fins. This is in the fish market in Tanjore Luar, in the island of Lombok. It's notorious among marine conservationists for its shark and manta ray fisheries, which supplies the Chinese market. Both adults and pups are landed here, and by all accounts, shark populations in the surrounding waters have been so severely depleted that Jocelyn says that the fishermen move like robots. They're not even looking. They're just slicing, 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 slicing. It's like, look, do us a favor. You go to any of these restaurants, just don't order shark fin soup. Just don't do it, you know. It's as good as eating tiger bone. These are the apex predators of the ocean. And because we can't see them, and because somebody saw Jaws 100 years ago, they're not dangerous. We kill 100 million sharks, and they might, by mistake, kill 40 of us in a year. I've been told not to get angry. So we have another one. Arka Pavra Ghosh. This, we call it Kolkata Blues, or Roads to Nowhere, you know. In the rapidly developing satellite city of New Town, Kolkata, a place for wildlife is swiftly shrinking, where villages like Rajarhat and Bhangar, established by water bodies and agricultural lands, now stand towering malls, offices. And what happens is that you'll get a jackal trying to run across the road and the jackal goes. Now, so the point is that photographers, they know what to do. They put this thing down, they take it, they send it to us. We try to use it to convince people to live a slightly different world. Shashank Dalvi again. I tell you, Anish, he's a friend of yours. He's a student of Parvesh's. This is a boy who we've got to watch. He's going to be way up over there on the top of the firmament of conservation at some point. In India, the Nicobar long-tailed or crab-eating macaque is found on just 3 islands of its namesake archipelago, Great Nicobar, Little Nicobar, and Kachal. This subpopulation is listed as vulnerable, but not much is known of its population dynamics following the 2004 tsunami. Something has happened. Habitats have changed, humans have come in, different things have been done, some retaliatory hunting takes place, the population is decreasing. Shashank photographed this macaque and snared by a nylon trap, burying its fangs in anguish and terror, his wound raw where the rope cuts into its flesh. These are silent deaths. You don't hear them, they just die. So, I think we've seen not so nice pictures, but I also think it's time for us to see much, much better ones. We felt the heartbreak. I think it's time to feel a touch of gratitude for this magnificent planet. Let's get to our winners. Parvesh, ready? Joint third prize. Ripon Biswas, a peculiar piscata. This, the Sanctuary Wildlife Photography Award third prize goes to him for capturing this amazing image in a seasonal swamp in West Bengal's Cooch Behar district. This is a fishing spider, and it reels in its catch. The plant supports the spider that holds the fish that kisses the water. A perfect depiction of just one of the infinite links between terra firma and aqua terra. It took Biswas an entire year after first chancing upon a spider eating a fish in the swamp to find and get just that right moment. Apart from being an uncommon record, our judges found this image sharp, technically excellent, and illustrative of animal behavior. Joint third prize, Raman Kulkarni. He called it featherweight, heavyweight. On a forest path in Parpoli village in Sindhudurg, he came across a small pile of feathers that belonged to a yellow-browed bulbul. On closer examination, he realized the feathers were being ferried away by an army of ants. You know, and this delicate detail of the feather, its quill in the iron grip of the insect, and fine focus, they all came together to make a really remarkable image of one of nature's micro-titans, the ant, you know. Interestingly, we asked a lot of entomologists as to why would an ant collect a feather, you know, what would it do? So there were all kinds of things that come up and we researched and we found, and some people theorized that it could be a source of food, with the ants eating the bird tissue that clings to the calamus, or that it could be a device perhaps used to just collect morning dew. We don't know what, but it's fantastic. Pinal Patel and Shaurya Shashwat Shukla, dogs of war, the second prize. Just look at that. Masters of tactical warfare, this pack of 22 dholes implemented a foolproof plan to subdue a massive somber stag in velvet. The combined weight of the pack of whistling hunters is probably less than that of the stag, maybe a little more. But their attack strategy was flawless. Some stood sentry on the lookout for competing predators, some converged on their quarries, others waited their turn to replace any soldier that tired. It took 2 hours. And in 2 hours, they not only killed it, but almost finished it to the bone. In nature, nothing is ever, ever wasted. After this, dogs have finished with this, you can be sure that the beetles will come, the other things will come, and when all the bones are lying around, a porcupine will nibble away at it. And we come to the first prize. We had a lot of debate. Biju Boro is in the hall with us. We call it the tyranny of man. Stunned by the pinch of a tranquilizing dart, exhausted, disoriented by the clamor of a mob, a conflict leopard reluctantly slows its pace. This is on the outskirts of the Guwahati city in Assam. The cat found itself in the eye of a storm, chased by angry locals, pursued by worried forest officers. This particular cat was spared death at the hands of the crowd. The forest officers, at great risk to themselves, they saved the cat. This cat didn't die. But believe me, your newspapers show it, your YouTube show it, your Facebook shows it. There are cats being bludgeoned. There are bears being burnt. The resilience that we used to have is being tested. So the only way that Why did we choose this? First of all, as journalists, we found this to be a remarkable picture. If you ever find yourself looking at a picture in a conflict situation, look whether you're on the side of the guys firing the bullets or are you on the side of the guys facing the bullets. Look where this guy is. He's on the other side of the mob, you know, and the leopard's coming towards him, but he still managed to get the... Biju, great, great, great picture. Great picture. Great picture. So, it's been an extraordinary ride, but it's not over yet. To honor our winning photographers, we have with us a couple, Himendra mentioned them, who for over 25 years brought Africa's wilds to the world. Conservationists, award-winning filmmakers, world-renowned photographers, they're National Geographic explorers in residence. Beverly and Derek Joubert, here's to you guys. They've produced 22 films, 10 books, 6 scientific papers. Together they've received 5 Emmy Awards, a Peabody and the World Ecology Award. You just saw some of their breathtaking images up on the screen now. And Derek and Beverly, please come up on stage. May we request you to present our winners their very well-earned certificates. They will also receive something they're very bound to find pretty useful out in the bush. It's a home on the run for their very precious camera from Wolf Pro. You get that as well, please.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Welcome. Let me call my photographers up. I'll be with you in a minute.
So, can we have our photographers up? My friends?
There you are. That's the joint third prize. Raman Kulkarni. That's the joint third prize. Pinal Patel and Shaurya Shashwat Shukla, both of you come together. They refused to take the individual, they took separate pictures, but they said we were in the same place at the same time, it's our photograph, we share it. So they share that award. Dogs of War. Biju Boro. Photographer of the Year. And do we have the badge? You're a really, really good guy. Look. Look what we've got for you, Biju. That's just to make sure that your bag holds your cameras and keeps them protected. And we'll have more for you there. There you go. Thank you very much. Thank you. Take care. Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you, Beverly. Watch your step as you get down. Now, may I look for somebody called Dia Mirza to come and take charge. Anybody seen her? Dia? It's your stage.
The most delightful.
Wow, wasn't that incredible? Can we do another quick round of applause? Wonderful, thank you. Sanctuary's Wind Under the Wings Award is presented to a non-wildlife organization that has encouraged one or more of their employees to stretch their wings in the direction of wildlife conservation using their inner purpose and resources. In my own home state, the Telangana State Special Protection Force has in its ranks a woman whose dynamic leadership has seen the revitalization of a lake ecosystem that seemed damaged beyond recovery. She is the Director General of the State Special Protection Force, and she convinced the District Collector to allow the SPF to adopt the Aminpur Lake. In the weeks that followed, she motivated her staff to undertake cleanliness drives, organize awareness sessions and health camps for villagers, stand up to polluting industries, and stop the illegal drilling of bore wells in the area. As wetland birds returned to the lake and its waters began to run clean, Aminpur became the first water body in the country, hold your breath, to be labeled a biodiversity heritage site. Poet, feminist, member of the Indian Police Service, environmentalist, she is now looking to adopt and revitalize the Fox Sagar Lake. Her no-holds-barred approach and environmental restoration initiatives are completely supported by the force. And for this, we honor Tejdeep Kaur Menon and the Telangana State Special Protection Force. May I request Padma Bhushan Julio Francis Ribeiro, survivor of two assassination attempts and author of Bullet for Bullet, My Life as a Police Officer, hero to us all, to please come up on stage to present the Wind Under the Wings Award to Tejdeep Menon and the Telangana State Special Protection Force. Ladies and gentlemen, Tejdeep Menon. Oh, that felt so good. Thank you, Mr. Ribeiro. And thank you and congratulations, Mrs. Menon. Those nurturers who introduce children to nature hold a special place in sanctuary's heart. Every year, we go in search of educationists who have risen beyond the confines of academia to instill wonder and respect for our living planet in the next generation. This year, we found two inspirational men of stamina truly worthy of being called green teachers. Retired school teachers, aged 84 and 74 years young, this duo has been conducting the Panna Nature Camps ever since its inception in 2010. Their friendship dates back to the 1950s when they were a student-teacher duo themselves. Together, they have taken on the task of connecting the children of Panna with the natural treasures in their backyard. Other than organizing camps, they regularly visit local schools to ensure that their wards remember to keep some water out for birds in summer, plant and care for saplings, recycle paper, and so much more. With foresight, and in light of their advancing years, they have also spent the last 2 years training two individuals to carry their work forward. Paid a modest stipend of just Rs. 700 per camp, they say, "Humko na dam chahiye na naam. Hum chahte hain karna keval kaam." They are the oaks under whose shade generations of Panna's youth have taken root and whose eyes they have opened to the magic of nature. And for this, we honor Sri Ambika Khaire and Sri Devi Datta Chaturvedi. Our Green Teachers of the Year 2016. May I request Urvi Piramal, conservation supporter and chairperson of the Piramal Group, to please come up on stage to honor Sri Khare, who is here alone today as Sri Chaturvedi was not well enough to travel. Okay, I'm going to quickly go and get that. Here it is. Thank you so much, ma'am. Congratulations, sir. You've met some of today's Earth heroes, but tomorrow's are just as inspiring. At the Sanctuary Nature Foundation, we know that no conservation victory is permanent, and the only solution is to keep on keeping on. We are lucky that to have young adults in this country who wear the expectations of older conservationists with grace. They are shattering glass ceilings, making new discoveries, creating fresh solutions, and challenging the status quo. It is on their sturdy shoulders that the future of India rests. Meet Sanctuary's young naturalists of 2016. Just 24 years old, he has already discovered 6 new species of spiders in India. Two of which belong to a rare ant-mimicking family. I got that right, Pittu. Reported for the first time from Asia. He's creating baseline data for the conservation of less popular species, and in the course of his master's dissertation? Yeah. Right. He located 77 different species of spiders on the Gujarat University campus alone. With papers published in some of the world's leading journals, including Zootaxa and the Journal of Threatened Taxa, Dhruv Prajapati is following his passion and in the process adding to India's database of wild species. Dhruv Prajapati. This young woman has worked as a naturalist in Nepal's Chitwan National Park. Here, she has learned the skills of the mahouts, established a standard operating procedure for elephant care, and learned Nepalese to be accepted by locals. After the devastating Nepal earthquake, she started a local chapter of the National Safe to Travel campaign and organized capacity building workshops for communities. By teaching English, computer skills, and first aid, she empowered local Tharu tribals. Her seniors at Pagdandi Safaris tell us that, among other things, she helped young local women to believe in themselves. Vinita Yadav is tomorrow. In the world of Indian herpetology, sensational serpents like cobras and vipers take center stage. But our next young naturalist is dedicated to understanding the small, elusive, burrowing, blind snakes. He undertakes back-breaking fieldwork and tedious lab work with equal integrity and patiently reads every scientific paper of relevance that he can get his hands on. To his credit, he already has the discovery of a species of fan-throated lizard in India, and many more papers await publication. We believe that young Akshay Khandekar already is and will continue to be a huge asset to India. You young naturalists are our hope for tomorrow, and for this, we honor you. May I invite Ravneet Gill, sir, please, CEO, Deutsche Bank India, to please come up on stage to present the awards to our future, our hope for tomorrow. Dhruv Prajapati. Vinita Yadav. Akshay Khandekar. Thank you, Ravneet. Bittu, it's back to you, sir.
Thank you.
Aye.
Thank you, thank you, thank you. Do I get yet another hug?
No.
No. Hey, can't blame me for trying. Right? Look, it's been one of the things that Sanctuary does to say to everybody that you don't have to go and climb the highest mountain, dive down into the deepest oceans and walk the deserts of the world to do good. You can do this wherever you are. And we have in this room people who are doing what they can. Gandhiji had said something that the person who does nothing because he can't do everything is the worst of the lot. And here we have tremendous people, tremendous, tremendous people right here in the audience. Let me sort of shine a spotlight on some of them. Payal Sampath, where are you? Please stand. Researcher, author, climate warrior. Payal, I've loved you from the day you were born, right here. And I celebrated the day you graduated from Xavier's, and I thought you'll go into this job and that job. I had no idea after you joined the Bombay Environment Action Group and then World Watch. I had no idea then how entwined your life purpose and mine would become. Today, as International Program Director of Earthworks Washington, you're compelling global mining giants to clean up their mess. This Bombay girl is basically saying, mine if you have to, but mine responsibly. Stay out of fragile ecosystems, respect community rights, say no to extraction if it must, and it's going to destroy biodiversity. You're building a brighter future for us all, Payal. Thank you very much, and you're making one huge difference. Thank you. Gangadharan Menon, kahan hai aap? Ganga. This man is a teacher, he's a documentary filmmaker, travel writer. He also is an advertising professional who loved the same guy that I loved. He's not here right now, Ravi Gupta, but I think we share a love for that man. Very few people know, Ganga, that what you did way back, you know, in the saving of Silent Valley, people like you don't get recognized for having added just that little bit to it, you know. You demonstrate the veracity of my refrain that, look, if you're a poet, write poetry. If you're a writer, write. If you're a businessman, use your influence. If you're a politician, change policy. Any one of us can do what we have to do. You represent that. You know what he did?
Way back in 78, he took his camera to a little-known forest in Kerala where he filmed the lion-tailed macaques, leopards, Ceylon frogmouths, elephants, and his footage helped Dr. Salim Ali and luminaries such as M.K. Prasad and Dr. V.S. Vijayan to highlight the threats to Silent Valley, which became the rallying cry for India's environmental movement, and the public outcry that came and the scientific papers that were published saying this is not a project that will work. Thank you very much. You made a difference, Ganga. You made a huge difference by doing just that. Purushottam Lal Gupta, kahan hai bhai sahab aap, kahan hai? Inko to taliyan bahut bajani padegi. Honorable Chief Minister, this is an auto driver. He drives an auto rickshaw. He loves trees. He is one of the Mumbaikers who are really going to save this country. In Julio, when he is ferrying people to and fro, you know, in Thane, his heart breaks when he sees ki either trees are being cut or the new trees being planted are just not being looked after. So what he did was he started carrying water in his auto. Jahan bhi dekha to usne pani dal diya wahan, you know. His rickshaw fellow friends said, "Kya kar rahe ho?" So they said, "Main to yehi kar raha hu." So they started doing the same thing also. So now suddenly, lots of people started doing this, and he started something called Sadbhavna Hara Bhara Bharat. Purushottam Lal ji, aapke 50 dost ho gaye. 50 of his auto rickshaw guys are doing the same thing right now. Everything that we have to do can be done. You know, Praveen, you know how they communicate. This is an age of, they have a WhatsApp group, you know. Yeah, fantastic. Purushottam ji, you're making a huge difference. Julius Rego, please stand. Where are you? Green soul, organic farmer, solutions provider. By passion, he's an organic farmer. He uses nutrition to help heal patients at the National Burns Hospital in Airoli. You converted a vacant plot owned by the Tata Memorial Hospital in Khargar into a flourishing organic farm. Your green thumb has given birth to dozens of tiny kitchen gardens across Mumbai. Schools, corporate housing societies attend regular urban farming workshops so they can create their own green food factories. This man is actually writing the future for us. Mumbai will use its roofs, it will use its traffic gardens, it will use the public spaces on the fringes to grow food. Why not? The Mughals used to do that. That was the Grand Trunk Road. Sahab, Julius, you're making a huge difference. Brian Miranda, where are you? Please stand. Look at the diversity of people. Brian is a municipal councillor in Kalina in Mumbai. Now, after 2 decades of protests, complaints, disputes, struggle, you revived a 3-century-old pond in Kalina's Koloveri village. As many as 400 illegal shanties had mushroomed on the dry pond, and with them all the construction debris, garbage, free for all, open toilet, all that was going on over there. He didn't like this at all, and so in the adjacent Shastri Nagar Municipal School, then it was just a little asbestos shed surrounded by filth, he catalyzed action. He worked with BMC officials, he revived the water body, he built a proper school, a football field, a garden, a playground for our children. Mumbai has 100 more places waiting for you. Brian, you have a magic touch, you're making a difference. Dr. Usha Desai, Reni Vyas, where are you? Big hug for you. Ravneet, I hug everyone, you included. Huh? Tree lovers, green champions, one a doctor, the other a businesswoman. Since 2010, you have volunteered and conducted nearly 100 absolutely free tree appreciation walks during different seasons in gardens. All they do is take people around and say, look at this tree, this is what it does, look at this, these are the insects, these are the birds, look what happens, see this, and suddenly they find people falling in love, you know, flowers, birds, insects. In addition to those who are motivated, you share seeds of native trees. They're saying, take the local trees, don't try to get, you know, species from here and there, take the local trees. You're passionate about protecting Mumbai's green cover. You understand that those who appreciate will come forward to protect. Usha Desai and Rene Vyas, you're making a huge difference. Thank you very much. Karuna Singh, stand. Humanist, networker, earth protector. What a life you've led. Born into an army family, those of you who know what army families are, she's been everywhere in this country, seen things that people have never seen, gone to places that some people think are difficult to go to, but she's loved every moment of that. She got married at 21, worked as an official at the US State Department in Kolkata. She refused to let personal tragedy, I'm not going into the tragedy, but you refused to let anything get you down. You threw yourself into public service. Decades ago, you realized that there was no public service as vital as waking people to the dangers of a degraded environment. As country director today for the Earth Day India Network, you and your team reach out to 35 million rich and poor Indians, basically to say you can make a difference, go out and protect. And you enroll them in the task of fighting climate change by protecting the environment. And Karuna, you're making a huge difference. Anil and Nipa Ranka, aap kahan hai? There you are, please stand. These guys, you've got to listen to what they do, because in your pocket is something that you will at one point throw away and they'll look after it. Alarmed at the casual way the rest of us dispose of highly toxic electronic waste, they decided that, look, let the pollution control board do what it does, but we can't wait for them and dump everything on them. So they decided that they'll start asking their friends, ki bhai koi ceremony ho, to hame koi nahi gift mat dena, aapki phati purani tooti hui cheezein jo electronic hai, wo hame de do. So they started doing, gathering those things, and you know, at this point, across India, e-waste is a 3.2 million ton headache. There's all kinds of toxic carcinogenic material in that. We casually dump it, and that's not the way to go. And what they did is that they gathered their residents in Walkeshwar. They got in touch with ethical waste recyclers, and together they set up 8 collection bins. Each of those bins, every month, 30 to 40 kilos of that electronic waste they collect, and they get it scientifically and correctly recycled, gets used, and somewhere a child, a parent, or relative is saved from exposure to cancerous chemicals that we normally do. Anil and Nipa Ranka, you're making a huge difference. Anubhav Pal, are you here? Anubhav Pal. Stand-up comic, playwright, novelist. Anubhav, we first met when you performed at the solar-powered festival Sunplug that was sponsored by Deutsche Bank way back in 2013. And at Bhavan's College at that point, I really, really thought you'd join our mission, you know. But unfortunately, instead of helping the environment, you become Donald Trump-like in your denial of climate change. I don't know how this happened. You become number one polluter with your jokes to start with. And you've left a colossal carbon footprint. And this is not a reference to your size. Huh? I'm not insulting you. No, Anubhav, I'll tell you something. Listen. I know, I'm telling you. Listen. Before you say anything.
I know you disturbed a lion, you lied to a coral reef, you cheated a whole forest, and you demonetized the ozone layer.
Yes. I also don't know why I have a microphone. But too, I have some things to say in my defense.
Bolo? That
was quite easy. Ladies and gentlemen, for those that haven't caught on yet, this was somewhat pre-planned. Very serious evening so far, very serious. Lots of things are dying. We will change focus now from animals to humans for a little bit. And I was told, Bitu and I had a challenge going on, that environmentalists, do they have a sense of humor? Do they not have a sense of humor? I have a feeling you have a sense of humor. You have to, the planet is ending. That's your starting question. If I'm making an omelet, someone comes over, by now you've realized the next 10 minutes, you've heard the graceful part of the evening, this is the disgraceful part of the evening. There is going to clearly be some stand-up comedy for the next few minutes, if you haven't gathered that already. And I don't know whether the stand-up comedy is on this stage or with the planet outside. But I've been told, you see, environmentalists, their first line is very tricky. You go to anyone's house and you're having dinner, it's all lovely. And they start with that. They said, why are we, the planet is ending. I was just eating this omelette. I don't know what to do about this. And it's worse for me. It's worse because we will spend a little time talking about India. I am Bengali. You're already laughing. Why does the country laugh at us? I guarantee we're not the bravest Indians. Look what we've done. All the photography winners are Bengalis. We went there, we took a photo, we said, now it's your problem. Any Punjabis here? See, I love Punjabis. They have one solution to climate change. Who do I shoot? Kisko goli maru? Abhi maar deta hu. Ozone layer, kahan hai wo? No, I don't go beyond worldly, no. Any Gujaratis here? Lovely, welcome. The markets are closed, where else would they be? All the Gujaratis, this is not that kind of sanctuary. You still have to declare your cash. It's hard, we're a very, 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 that's stereotypes, very bad, very bad. But we stereotype in this country. This is what we do to humans. I'm going to come to animals later. If you're Nepalese and you live in India, doesn't matter what you do. You could work on the Hadron Collider. You could split the atom. Does not matter. If you're Nepalese, someone in India at some point will tell you, ye gaadi park kar dena. But I'm Dr. Shishtha, I teach at Harvard. Lovely, gate bhi band kar dena. We're not listening. This is the problem. I don't know why I said that in a British accent. This is the thing. You know, I think we need more diverse Indians. Any South Indians here? Yeah, I love it. Any Tamilians? Superb, very fond of them. They're already writing an equation to solve climate change. dydx of 9 by 36. I love Tamilians. But you know, here's my problem with them. There's no middle ground. There's no Tamilian who just got 50% in his exams. No. They either have Ramanujan or Rajnikant. Why is that? Why? They're either splitting an atom or shooting a cigarette saying, Raskala. Why? You know who I think will solve climate change? Bangaloreans. Any Bangaloreans here? Yeah? Love Bangaloreans. They put everything on an app. Everyone in Bangalore, every problem you have, their answer is just start a, do a startup. I, Bebo, you, Bewakoof, whatever. Make my trip, take my wife, whatever. Whatever. That's not an offer. This is going out of hand. Diverse, very diverse country. It's very hard to explain. Any Sindhis here? Of course, it's free. Where else will you be? Hong Kong is a long way away. I love it, I love it. You know, in the old days, you could solve any problem in the world, in India, if you spoke English properly. Especially in South Bombay. Hello! For climate change, I'm speaking properly. It didn't matter what you were saying in Hindi. Albert Einstein could have said, Sir, mujhe lagta hai time or space relative hai, aur ye ek cosmos mein, ek infinitum mein jata hai. Chup, gaadi chalao. Tum kya bol rahe? Properly, lovely. But you can't solve problems just by speaking like that anymore. See, I'm from Calcutta. I have a problem. No one told us the British left. That's why I live in NCPA, right behind. No one told them the British left either. We're all still here speaking properly. What? No? Hello? Like someone was poking us with a javelin. But in real India, people are making change. You met your earth heroes. They're people from across India. When you just speak properly now, you sound like a fool. You sound like a love child of Shashi Tharoor and Karan Thapar. Properly. Punjabis, I'll explain all the jokes afterwards. Meet outside. We have to talk about the environment. So serious, so serious. But you know, here's the thing. It is ridiculous, our planet. You know what the problem is, though? The problem is us, human beings. See, animals are not coming to our house. Who? We go to Bandhavgarh, we go to Penge. A group of bears are not going to Bandra. They're not looking at us, see how auntie's eating. This is our problem. One guy's like, yeah, I dove in the Atlantic Ocean and the shark bit me. That's his house. He's not coming to Sakinaka to bite you, nah. It's unbelievable. And we do insane stuff with animals. Insane. I don't know who thinks this also. Who thinks this up? In the old India, in the time of the empire, we used to use elephants to play polo. Imagine what the elephant is thinking. Baga, I'm an elephant. You want me to run towards a goalkeeper? You've seen me, horse. It's unbelievable. I was in Dubai recently. Dubai, wow, they have so much money. They have so much money that they are altering the planet. In the desert, they bought a ski slope. In the Mall of the Emirates, they've bought a whole ski slope. And the man is showing off. He's like, you know, Switzerland, they have mountains. We picked it up, brought it here. They have an aquarium, and in the aquarium, they've got a shark. The guy told me, Atlantic Ocean, there is shark. We brought shark. They said, you cannot have Atlantic Ocean. It belongs to an ocean. We said, no, buy Atlantic Ocean. Ski slope belongs to Switzerland. Buy Switzerland. There's a shark. He's showing off. He's like, look, there is shark. You like Jaws shark. We have brought it. And there's a shark going around in the mall. And I kept thinking, what is going through the shark's head? The bugger's like, I was in Jaws. Now I'm staring at a sign that says Zara. Wait. There's a sail on. Wait, I'm not a Sindhi shark. What's wrong with me? What's wrong? I'd gone to Gujarat to see the lions in Gir Forest. Anyone been? Amazing lions in Gir Forest. Gujarat, the economy of Gujarat is growing at 14%. Fastest economy in the world. Even the lions are growing at 14%. They're like, how Japanese FDI here? I'm growing. But this is the Indian mindset. I can't understand. We went to see lions, middle of summer. The lion didn't come out. And I was sitting with an old Indian uncle. I love Indian uncles. Because Indian uncles have no filter from here to here. Should I say this? Is this appropriate? Nothing. Just whatever. Just say it. we're going in this van to see a lion. I'm not talking to him. He looks at me, he said, you're damn fat. You're Marwari. I almost said, yes, uncle, yeah, yeah. We went to the forest. There was no lions. Middle of summer, no lion. Uncle got upset. He's a Gujarati uncle. He said, I've paid full price. No lions have come. What kind of forest is this? He went to the forest reserve officer. He said, what kind of forest are you running? No lion came out. What kind of forest is he running? This is not Indigo Delhi. What kind of forest? I thought the forest reserve officer would say, you get out of my office. When you go whale watching off the coast of the Atlantic, you don't write a letter to Obama. Mr. President, you said there would be hope in whales. There was no hope, there were no whales. And Obama will write back saying, like the Congress, even the whales don't listen to me. That's an aside, but here's the problem. So uncle on the other side, he's also an uncle, Forest Reserve officer. So I thought he'll say, acha, he'll tell us to get out, nothing. But he stands up. He said, what do you mean you didn't see a lion in my forest? You didn't see a lion? Come with me. Now I'm sitting between two uncles. He also starts, you're damn fat, Marwari. Only in India, we go in the middle of the forest. He stands up. He says, how can the lion not come out? I'm an IAS officer. He says, lion, 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 and the lion comes out. Because only in India, even the lion is thinking, I don't know who he knows. You have changed for 2,000 rupees. Happy. It's a lion. It's not like the lion was calling the forest reserve officer saying, aaj kitne log aa rahe, kitne log aa rahe. No, 3 o'clock, I have a manicure. No, then I'm going to see that French movie. And it's a Gujarati lion. Obviously, he's not going to come out. He'll come out for 2 minutes. He'll be, ah! And then Tata Steel, kitne beja rahe, kitne beja rahe. I'll leave you with this last story. It's insane what's happening with animals. My father-in-law just retired. And like all older people that retire, he's got a hobby now. He's a wildlife photographer. He takes photos of elephants. He showed me, he said, what do you think? Do you think they're like Raghu Rai? I said, ha ha, superb. What an elephant, superb. He said, that's my wife. I said, we went to Madhumalai Forest Reserve with him. We're sitting there. We've taken a tour guide. And these tour guides in these forests, they are very dangerous people because they get paid based on how much information they give you. Most of the information is rubbish. We passed two Swedish people. He said, ek baat batao sir, ye log animals nahi hai. We go in the middle of the forest and I've never seen this incredible sight. There were two elephants, male and female. They were trying to embrace each other. Standing on their hind legs, they're trying to hug. It's the biggest, two giant elephants, giants. And it's the biggest thing I've ever seen in my life. Once you see that, every problem in your life is small. Because you're like, whatever, demonetization, love, anything. You're like, yeh dekh le, ab kya baki hai? And one of the elephants had made eye contact also. He said, yeah, when your parents said, do something big with your life, this is what it looks like. And he's hugging. And you know what the tour guide says suddenly? He says, I'll ek information batao sir. We said, what? Ye uska biwi nahi hai. He said, his wife is gone on holiday. Not one person in the jeep said, how do you know? You know what my father-in-law said? Youngsters nowadays. You've been fantastic. Thank you for that.
I can't do this. I can't. My sides hurt and my cheeks hurt. Bittu had said, you know, once Anubhav is done, you need to bring back the gravitas to the situation. There's no gravitas left in me, Bittu.
Try.
Oh, dear God. You know, every now and then we need reminding that as much as the world needs Earth heroes, it also needs laughter and good humor. So, Anubhav, thank you so much. I shall compose myself now. You know, there are some very incredible individuals amongst us tonight. He's already been introduced, but I'd like to take the opportunity, it's my honor, sir, to introduce you to Lord Nicholas Stern of the London School of Economics and author of the path-breaking climate document, The Stern Review. He is also director of the India Observatory and chair of the Center for Climate Change Economics and Policy. Last evening, on the invitation from the Sanctuary Nature Foundation, he engaged with some of India's leading economists, bankers, and conservationists to underscore the threats from climate change to the global economy and the opportunities that a new non-carbon economy has to offer. Lord Stern, may I request you to please address us.
Ladies and gentlemen, you could not have had a clearer warning. I'm going to address you on climate change with an English accent. But I have to warn you, it's a West London English accent. But thank you for that very kind introduction. Thank you, Bittu and Madhu, for inviting me. Thank you, Chief Minister, for inviting me to speak last night. It was a great honor to be able to talk last night, and it's a great honor that you are with us today. It's enormously appreciated. Thank you very much. Now, we've all celebrated the tiger with Bittu, but we also know that those wonderful animals symbolize the forests. And we should also know, I think we do know, those of you here, how much we depend on our forests and our ecosystems. They shape our planet, they shape our lives. In the UK, when we denuded the hillsides, we cut the trees down from the hillsides, Earth there becomes less of a sponge, the water rushes down the mountainside, and we either get flooded or we have to invest in what we call infrastructure, dams and reservoirs and canals and things, in order to protect ourselves from the flooding. We should think of that soil and those trees at the top of the hills on the mountainsides. We should see those as our infrastructure, our natural infrastructure, just as we would see the water management lower down. If we start to lose the Amazon forest, then thousands of kilometers to the south, the great city of Sao Paulo would be completely without water, because what they call the river of the sky would run out of water. That's what supplies Sao Paulo. And of course, the forests themselves are the biggest, most important sink for greenhouse gases that we have on the planet. If we damage our forests, we damage ourselves locally, we damage ourselves regionally, and we damage the climate for the planet as a whole. If we let the climate run riot, we will damage our forests. If we don't look after our forests, we damage the climate. They live together, and we live together as totally dependent on those things. So how well are we doing? Well, the answer to that is not very well. We are roughly 1 degree centigrade above the usual benchmark of the second half of the 19th century. It doesn't sound very much, but we're on the edge of the period where we became civilized. The Holocene period, the last 9 or 10,000 years, has been a benign, stable climate, plus or minus 1 degree centigrade. We're on the borders of that already. We grew up in the last 9 or 10,000 years. We started cultivating grains. They came from the grasses. We became agricultural. We became settled. That's who we are in large measure. In a very benign corridor, plus or minus 1 degree centigrade, we're on the edge of that. That's why in the Paris Agreement, we said we have to stay well below 2 degrees. 2 degrees is already way outside that special benign Holocene period of the last 9 or 10,000 years. We're already moved out of that into the Anthropocene. We are ourselves making a profound difference to the planet. The planet's climate now is controlled by us and what we do. So 1 degree already borderline, staying well below 2 degrees, absolutely vital, but already into difficult territory. If everybody delivers what they promised to deliver in terms of emissions reductions in Paris, we would actually be heading for 3 degrees. And if we hadn't had Paris, we'd be heading for 4 degrees. We haven't seen 3 degrees on this planet for 3 million years. Homo sapiens, the generous definition of sapiens, has been around for 200 or 250,000 years. We haven't seen 3 degrees for 3 million. We've been around as Homo sapiens only for 250,000, and our basic civilization is just 9 or 10,000 years in that sense of being settled. So that is very dangerous territory. At 3 or 4 degrees centigrade, hundreds of millions, probably billions, would have to move because they were now in desert areas, because they were now flooded, because they were now battered by storms and hurricanes. They would have to move. If that many people move, you're very likely, if history teaches anything, to get conflict. And you can't make a peace treaty. You can't turn it off. You can't make a peace treaty with the planet. Those are the risks that we play for. So what can we do? As we say in India, what to do? Now, this what to do has to be not in resignation, but with a sense of purpose. And we can. We actually know what to do. We can build our cities so that they are uncongested and clean. We know how to design them in this way. Much more cycling, much more walking, much more public transport, means of transport that are clean, not dirty. We understand all that, and we're getting, or we can get, much better at it if we want to. We know about not cutting down the forests. We know about rehabilitating the grassland. We know how to do our agriculture in a different way. That decision now is up to us. There's still time. We're running out of time, but there's still time. But it's very important to understand that sense of urgency. We will double the economy of our planet probably in the next 20 years. We will more than double the infrastructure in that time. Will that extra economy we build, will that extra, more than extra infrastructure, it will go up by an additional 1.3, 1.4, will that infrastructure be clean and uncongested, or will it be like we have at the moment, dirty and wasteful? Well, it's our choice. We can do it one way or the other. If we do it in the sensible way, we have cities where we can move and breathe and be productive. We have ecosystems that are robust and survive and serve us well. Or we do it the other way, and it's entirely up to us. But this next 20 years will be decisive. Well, those decisions will determine whether this is the best of centuries or the worst of centuries. It's in our hands. So that is the choice we have to make now. For India, it's even more special. India will probably, if it grows at 7% for 20 years, and if that's good growth, we hope it does, that will quadruple. You'll be being three extra economies alongside the one you have. Are those three going to be clean and attractive and productive? Or are they going to be a bit like what we're starting to build now? That's a choice. India is in the good fortune of having started its urbanization a little bit later than other places. That is an enormous advantage. It's the advantage of being able to do things differently. I believe that India, which will be the driver of much of the world economy, economic change in the next 20 years, has it in its hands to do it differently. When I look at the people in this room, I believe that India has the people to create this new world and to insist that it's done differently. And we will be much better off as a result. There's no horse race between living standards and climate responsibility. They come together. If we abandon one, we abandon the other. So India, I'm convinced, will be in the lead on this story. And I'd also like to recognize where we are in India, in Maharashtra. Maharashtra is in the vanguard. We're seeing here pioneering of water harvesting, commitment to growing forests, planting trees, building and protecting national parks. We're seeing the buildings of mass transit, metros and, of course, buses to go with them. We're all going too slowly. I'm sure that the world is going too slowly. Probably India's going too slowly. Even Maharashtra may be going too slowly. But there's a real opportunity here. Maharashtra is in the vanguard of India, and I believe that India is in the vanguard of the world. That's why I'm so happy to be here and so honored to speak to you tonight. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Lord Stern. I think you remind each one of us, what Rumi said, that we are not a mere drop in the ocean, but the entire ocean in a drop. Thank you. Honorable Chief Minister, as you have often stated, Maharashtra's wilds are cherished havens of biodiversity. The policies put in place by you, such as the Shyam Prasad Mukherjee Jan Van Vikas Scheme for the development of villages around tiger reserves, have allowed 30 villages to be voluntarily shifted out of forests without dissent, creating more space for wildlife and vastly improving the quality of life of its villagers. This is a result of your far-sighted generosity in offering greater financial and land compensation. Maharashtra's wilds also stand protected because of the untiring, unsung work of an army of forest guards and officials. Supported by the Wildlife Conservation Trust today, we would like to honor four such guardians with sanctuaries, Special Maharashtra Wildlife Awards. Atul Deokar studied endangered wild buffaloes in the Kolamarka Conservation Reserve in Gachiroli. When Naxalite activity prevented forest staff from carrying out their duties, Deokar engaged local communities in water conservation works critical to saving the wild buffalo population from local extinction. Presently posted at the East Panch Range of the Panch Tiger Reserve in Maharashtra, Deokar continues to shine. Surajpal Gorelal Belkar knows that surviving in Koktu in the Gugamal division of the Melghat Tiger Reserve is tough. A forest van mazdoor, he travels 50 kilometers just to get rations. He has amazing stories to tell, including one time when he nabbed two poachers and held them for 2 days until senior officers could reach Koktu. Despite suffering personal tragedies, this brave man has only one wish, to continue to serve his beloved Koktu. Shri Bhagwan has worked with almost all the wings of the Forest Department. Few people know that he was responsible in the late 90s for bringing about a change in attitudes and ushering in a new regime that resurrected tigers in the greater Tadoba landscape. He currently serves as the PCCF Wildlife and Chief Wildlife Warden of Maharashtra State. Our hopes rest on him. Savan Bahekar is the Honorary Wildlife Warden of Gondia District and the President of SEWA. He oversaw the revival of Saras cranes whose population had dropped to a perilous 4 in 2003. Today, thanks to Savan and SEWA, almost 50 Saras cranes have been recorded in the state. He also helps control wildlife crime, habitat encroachment, and mitigates human-animal conflict in the Navigaon Nagzira landscape. He is a de facto forest official without being appointed as one. Diverse as your interests, positions, and work may be, your purpose is one: to secure the country's stunning natural heritage. In the process, you work to safeguard our water sources, stabilize our climate, and mend the relationship between man and nature. And for this, we honor you. Honorable Chief Minister, may I please request you to join us on stage to present the Special Maharashtra Wildlife Service Award for 2016. Atul Deokar, Suraj Pal, Shri Bhagwan, and Savan Bahekar. Sir, please, I request you to stay back on stage. Thank you.
Honorable Chief Minister, Maharashtra, wildlife friends in the hall. Sir, because of your policies, schemes, action, reactions, we have got a lot in the conservation field, and wildlife of Maharashtra is progressing a lot. My request is that your support needs a lot. And because of your support, my team definitely will translate the dream of wild Maharashtra in reality as far as we are here. My today's prize money, I will donate it to Tiger Foundations of Maharashtra. And on behalf of my whole team, I thank the organizers for the whole everything. Thank you.
Honorable Chief Minister, sir, please address the audience.
Ladies and gentlemen, it is indeed a proud privilege to be part of this award ceremony. This is for the second time I am here. And every time I am amazed to see how the earth heroes are working to change our lives, to save this earth, to make this earth a better place for the generations. In Sanskrit we say, tena taktena bhunjita, tyag se sevan kari, consume with restraint. In our culture, we say that Mother Nature is like a cow. You can milk it, but you cannot exploit it. The moment you start exploiting a cow, it won't ever give you milk. And I think all of us must understand this. Although for last few years I could see a lot of people getting educated, doing different activities, but still we need to do more. There are so many conflicting interests. We need to moderate them. We need to understand the principle of sustainability. Even while in government, we always have two of our departments fighting for their projects. Because the conflicting interest, on one hand, a department wants to create infrastructure, on other hand, the department like environment, like forest, they want it to be sustainable. But I think out of this conflict, what comes out is the best. We try to create the infrastructure, but now we also look at the sustainability of what we create. I'm thankful to Lord Stern for showing us a roadmap of how we should go ahead. Because we are a developing country. And on one hand, we require to maintain the pace of our development. But on the other hand, we need to be cautious that the development doesn't become a disaster. And I think in the state of Maharashtra, with all these wonderful people here, we have started doing things more sustainably. So now we just don't look at creating big dams, big water storages, but we look more towards water conservation, creating the entire ecosystem as it was, with the approach of watershed development. And I'm happy that we could convert it into people's movement, where people participated, they understood that water conservation is key to sustainability, it's key to moisture security, it's key to sustainable agriculture. I'm happy to share that on 1st of July, on one single day, we could plant 25 million trees. And we created 5 Limca book records on one single day. And we used to say earlier that we plant trees at the same place every year. But it is no more a case. So every single plant is geotagged. It's monitored. We know where it is, how it is, how it's progressing. As rightly told by Lord Stern, we are trying to create more and more public transport. in Mumbai and in all our major cities, because I think the sustainability is key, and the government is one single entity which can take this sustainability to the scale. I'm sure the earth heroes like those who are recognized here inspire us. They make us think of what we do. They show us a way. They inspire us that in spite of not having the resources what the government has, if they could change, then with all the resources government has, the government can take the change to a pace to next level. And I think that is the commitment which I want to give today. Recently, I went to Taroba, and I could see Tigress Maya hunting for her cubs. And I think what I see, what I saw, I want generations to see that. I want our forests, our wildlife to be conserved. People like Bittu, Ramneet, they guide us, they inspire us. And I'm happy, and I must thank you for actually allowing us to look at the things in a different way. I would confess that 2 years back, when I was not part of the wildlife committee, I used to look at the things in a different way. The interest of infrastructure was more than sustainability. But now I understand that sustainability is the key. This is the inspiration which we get from the Earth Heroes. I must thank Sanctuary for these awards, and I'm sure we'll inspire more and more people, and we will join hands together to save our Mother Earth. Thank you. Thank you very much.
So I have to tell you that I was here the last time you were here, and I was so inspired by what you said that day. But I have to admit that I feel supercharged now with your commitment and your shared purpose that you have with each one of us here. Thank you so much. On behalf of the Sanctuary Nature Foundation, we promise to support every positive climate change and biodiversity protection policy that you introduce. Yes. He gave us a commitment. It's our turn to give him one as well. We're right by his side, always. For 17 years, the Sanctuary team has combed through the country to ferret out quiet men, women, and young adults to honor at the Sanctuary Wildlife Awards. They are our frontline defense against the defacing of our planet. Just take a look at the sheer spread of the Sanctuary Awardee Alumni Network. Okay, I promise you, it spreads across the length and breadth of this country, and it's a luminous display of hope, and I'm sure that it's going to add, and we're going to keep continuing to add to those bright sparks and honor the rest of our Earth heroes of 2016. The Sanctuary Wildlife Service Awards 2016. So many of us have gone numb to the devastation of our natural world. alienated from the elements of our insulated city lives. But these men and women, they fight on, determined to discover, revive, conserve, and protect the myriad species and ecosystems upon which our lives hinge. In the distant valley of Tawang in Arunachal Pradesh, a monk from the Monpa community is leading an environmental revolution. Part of the Save Mon Region Federation, he wants the wintering site of the revered black-necked crane saved. Led by the monks, the community fought off the powerful forces that wanted to drown the crane's fragile habitat under the massive Nyamjang Chu hydroelectric project. The National Green Tribunal validated the monks' protests and suspended the project's environmental clearances. Sadly, within weeks, our earth hero was arrested, allegedly for exposing corruption in such projects. Tragically, when supporters rallied to demand his release, they were shot at, and two died. Despite this wrenching setback, he continues to fight for the culture, water, land, and wildlife of his people, peacefully, with integrity and persistence. And for this, we honor Lama Lobsang Gyatso. May I request Usha Thorat, former Deputy Governor of the Reserve Bank of India and member of the Sanctuary Nature Foundation's Governing Board, to please come up on stage and present the award. Ladies and gentlemen, Lama Gyatso. Thank you, Usha.
Tashi Delek, good evening. First of all, I would like to thank Century for giving me this award. I received this award on behalf of Lamas and general citizens of Mon who formed SMRF, Save Mon Region Federation. And I would like to dedicate this award especially to Venerable Nyimandi and Sering Temba, who lost their life in police firing. And I would like to thank our lawyer, Ritvik Datta, for landslide judgment of NGT. Without him, it was not possible. And due to this judgment, the winter habitat of black-necked crane is being saved for the time being. And I'm really very happy, and I'm very happy that I get so much things to carry from here, especially the message from our honorable chief minister's view of sustainability development to our land, and all the achievement and the initiative of all earth savers and so many social workers. Thank you so much.
We're now going to zip from one end of the Himalaya to the other to reach a wild haven called Dachigam in Kashmir. This breathtaking park is the last bastion of the endangered Hangul deer. We have in this hall two men who protect and patrol this heaven on earth. One is a forest ranger who has wandered its paths since he was a child and can name virtually every species of flora and fauna you might encounter. Countless dissertations and research papers have been written based on the knowledge he has shared. Yet, he has rejected every promotion offered to him because he refuses to move away from his beloved Tachigaon. I love his smile. A flautist, poet, and romantic. He composes shairis, I've heard one myself recently, in ode to nature as he leads awestruck visitors through the park. Our second earth hero is the wildlife warden, Central Kashmir, an officer of immense principle. He has worked across the cold deserts of Ladakh, studying the migration of black-necked cranes and bar-headed geese, tracking Tibetan wild asses, and rescuing and rehabilitating an injured snow leopard. Today, despite the unrest that grips the valley, he continues to work to reduce grazing pressures on Tachigaon, keep his staff motivated, and give the critically endangered Hangul a new lease of life. They are the protectors of one of India's most beautiful and troubled landscapes. These men are tackling a Kashmir issue that few people know about. And for this, in the presence of Mr. Suresh Chugh, the wildlife warden of Jammu and Kashmir, we honor Forester Nazir Malik and wildlife warden of Tachigaon, Tahir Ahmed Shaul. Lord Stern, may I please request for you to present these outstanding men their joint Wildlife Service Award. Thank you, Lord Stern.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Honorable Chief Minister of Maharashtra, and thank you, all of you. Bahut-bahut shukriya mere do bachyon ke liye, Nazia aur Umar, jinhone mujhe bahut apna waqt diya hai is kaam ko. Bahut acha support mila hai unse. और मैं तमाम नेचुरलिस्ट को मुबारकबाद देता हूं कि जिन्होंने लोगों में एक अच्छे सोच को जन्म दिया है कि आज हमारा देश ये इसी सोच की एक कड़ी है कि हमारा देश एक स्वच्छता की ओर जा रहा है और आखिर में मेरी एक विनती है तमाम उन लोगों से जो हमारी धरती माँ को मैं उनसे रिक्वेस्ट करता हूँ कि हमारी धरती माँ को इसका सीना इतना कंक्रीट मत कीजिए Please. कि इसके दिल में हमारे लिए प्यार न रह जाए और इसकी ताज़ा हवाएं हमारे लिए जहरीले सांसें न बन जाए. थैंक यू. थैंक यू.
Honorable Chief Minister and distinguished guests, I am very thankful to Sanctuary Asia for selecting me for this prestigious award. I am privileged. I am thankful to my Chief Wildlife Warden, who is our leader, and he is among us today, Mr. Suresh Chu. I remember vividly, almost a year ago, when I joined as Wildlife Warden Central Srinagar, looking after one of the most wonderful places on the earth and wonderful national park that is known as Dachigam National Park. I was worried very much about the fate of a very endangered species of deer, which is found nowhere else in the world and is confined within the limits of the park. It is known as Hangul or the Kashmir stag. But some words of a hero, my mentor, who has always been an inspirational force behind me, Sir Bittu Sehgal, he called me and said, Tahir, don't worry, pura Hindustan tumhare saath hai, tumne Hangul ko bachana hai. I was so inspired with these words that we left no corner, and my team in the Dachigam National Park and the whole department of wildlife protection in Jammu and Kashmir, they are leaving no stone unturned to ensure that we save this critically endangered deer species on earth. Thank you very much. I am also thankful to our Honorable Forest Minister of Jammu and Kashmir, who is inspiration and force. He has been a rock behind us to support us to fight for the survival of Hangul and many other wildlife species and, in fact, the habitat. We all know that Jammu and Kashmir is a unique state with wonderful flora, fauna in all the three distinct regions. We are proud to have 60% population of snow leopard in our state, in Ladakh landscape. We are proud to have black-necked cranes breeding only in our state. And we are proud to have markhor, musk deer, and many other species of migratory waterfowl who are coming in thousands every year, every winter, in fact, to spend the winters in our wetlands. I am once again thankful to the supporters, to Sanctuary Asia, and to our mentors and friends. Thank you very much.
Our next Earth hero is a catwoman, a field biologist and conservationist who works to protect a secretive wetland inhabiting feline called the fishing cat in the southern part of her home state of West Bengal, She has identified three key occupation zones of the species and has mobilized action to save these marshlands from the land mafia. Her efforts have seen the arrest of five poachers and the filing of a public interest litigation. Her engagement with local agencies has led to the formation of several fishing cat protection committees in the Howrah district and a transformation in attitudes of locals towards their precious wetlands. A member of the IUCN Fishing Cat Working Group, she liaises globally with conservationists to raise the profile of this neglected species. She also regularly writes on conservation issues for national publications and is currently working on a documentary. A champion of wetlands and fishing cats, both of which are neglected by mainstream conservation efforts, her commitment to science and conservation is worthy of emulation. And for this, we honor Tiasa Adhya. May I request Dr. Anish Andheria, President of the Wildlife Conservation Trust, experienced field biologist, a friend, and long-term sanctuary supporter to come up on stage and present the award. That's why we love him. He doesn't wait.
Good evening, everybody. It's quite overwhelming to share the stage with people who put their lives in the line of fire for conservation. Yesterday, while talking to some of them, I realized the importance of the Sanctuary Awards logo. It's a huge responsibility that they have taken up, that of giving voice to nature. Thank you, Sanctuary Asia, for giving voice to the fishing cat. It is truly a unique species. We have 15 cat species in the country, and only one of them is a wetland specialist, that is the fishing cat. Wetlands like marshlands and mangrove swamps are the fishing cat's habitat. Not only are these water sinks, they are also known to be carbon sinks. As we have all agreed at the Fishing Cat Working Group, the fishing cat needs nothing else than protection of its habitat. By protecting its habitat, we will be doing a huge favor not only to the fishing cat, but also to ourselves. More and more such wetlands vanish from India, graver the consequences for us: drought, floods. Someone once said that the Fourth World War is going to be over water. Do we need to see more? Back home in the suburbs of Calcutta, many of us are trying to protect 1,500 hectares of marshland from land sharks. There is an ongoing court case for the last 4 years. We are facing pressures. Locals have been murdered. They are being intimidated. If you want, you can support us in our fight. In the recent Sanctuary Asia magazine, on the page on page 42, there is a campaign, and you can write to the Chief Minister of West Bengal to support us in our fight. You can spread the word. We won't be able to do it without you. Some good news as well. 18 villages from one district in West Bengal called Howrah submitted a proposal to the government to declare their village as a biodiversity heritage site for the fishing cat. Please do encourage them, spread the word in social media. Please accelerate the process of declaration. We might get our first fishing cat heritage site. Lastly, I do not consider myself to be a hero. I'm just a wildlife biologist. I'm no savior of the fishing cat. But all of us together can make a huge difference. I believe in that. I will stop.
You're the wind beneath our wings. You really are.
I'll stop now, but I have to thank a few good people. Foremost, my partner, Partho De, who is an experienced conservation practitioner. We have been working together. My activist lawyer friend, Meghna Banerjee. My super enthusiast wildlife friend, Shubhrajyoti Chatterjee. Mr. Pradhan and the youth of Kamar Goria local club. They are our grassroots conservationists, fishing cat conservationists. Also my mentors, Dr. Ajit Kumar, Dr. Shomita Mukherjee, Dr. Vidya Athreya, and Dr. Jim Sanderson, and of course my family. Thank you so much.
We find ourselves back in the stark, icy landscape of Kashmir, where our next Earth hero has helped to bring back Himalayan ungulates to lands once occupied by domestic livestock. He did this by working with the Snow Leopard Conservancy India Trust to enable pastoralists in Ladakh's Rumbak village in the Hemis National Park to earn more money from homestays than they could hope for from grazing livestock. A forest officer, his innovative conflict resolution programs have restored life to a stunning part of the park while dramatically improving the lives of the people. A member of the Jammu and Kashmir State Biodiversity Board, director of the Ladakh Renewable Energy Development Agency, and chief conservator of Forest Wildlife Ladakh, he will be remembered for giving the endangered snow leopard and other high-altitude Himalayan wildlife a fighting chance. He has demonstrated how real solutions are available for both people and parks, that they can work. And for this, we honor Jigmeet Thakpa. May I request Mr. Praveen Pardeshi, Principal Secretary to the Chief Minister and a discreet wildlife hero himself, to please join us on stage and present this award. Ladies and gentlemen, mountain man Jigmeet Thakpa.
Thank you, Sanctuary Asia magazine and its family. I'm really overwhelmed by the recognition that they have given me and the way they have chosen people all around India, recognizing the small effort that we do in our duty. From Ladakh to Jammu Kashmir to Arunachal Pradesh and Nagaland, they have been recognized. And there's a big responsibility for us to deliver more. This award means a big for us. It is a big incentive, it's a big encouragement, and for us, it is a big recognition that our small effort in the remotest part of the country is recognized at the national level. I really thank you all. Ladakh, as you know, falls in the trans-Himalayan region of India, and it is a cold desert. Nature has kept Ladakh high and dry and in cold. But this desert is brimming with life, especially the wildlife. And for many centuries, this was an area for games, especially for Maharajas and for the foreigners. And because of that, wildlife in that area had highly dwindled, and most of the species has gone locally extinct. But because of the conservation effort by the department, by the people, and by the local community. Wildlife in this area has recovered back. And today, the community effort, community program like ecotourism, homestays, nature guides, we are able to save, especially the snow leopard. And snow leopard in the world is not more than about 5,000 in number. And Ladakh, which hardly has less than 2 to 3% of the area of snow leopard, we have more than 25% of snow leopard of the world. Today, people all over the world are coming to see snow leopard, which is not been seen any part of the world. And we can give a guaranteed sighting of snow leopard in the wild if you come in winter. A National Geographic documentary that you have seen is shot in Himis National Park. The photography of snow leopard mating done by Mr. Manish is done in our national park. And the way that we have done is that recognizing and understanding the human psyche. Human being by nature is very selfish, that I understand. So to tackle that his selfishness, we have come up with the alternate livelihood options rather than going for pastoral farming or subsistence agriculture. We have given them alternate livelihood in form of ecotourism. And because of ecotourism, people are able to earn much more revenue. And because of that, they protect the wildlife, and people around the world come and see snow leopard and stays in the homestays. So that is the model that we have developed, and it is working, and it is a model for many countries of the snow leopard range countries. So that is the small story about us, and I really thank again Sanctuary Asia Magazine, Deshi Bank, and Mr. Hemendra Kothari. And in the end, I will just say, I will use the punchline of Mr. Hemendra Kothari's DSP Black Rock that says, "Aap thoda kijiye, aage bahut bada hoga." Thank you. Thank you.
In 2013, birding enthusiasts across the world were shocked to discover the large-scale massacre of thousands of migrating Amur falcons in Doyang, Nagaland. The news dominated headlines for weeks. Very rapidly, conservation interventions came into play, and soon everyone had heard of the Amur falcon. None of this would have been possible without the network, intuition, and plain hard work of one woman. Founder of the Nagaland Wildlife and Biodiversity Conservation Project and an award-winning journalist, she first led a team to the Doyang Reservoir to confirm rumors of the massacre in 2012. Following this, she and her team met with people ranging from the chief minister of the state to members of village councils, and ultimately, the Pangti Village Council declared a ban on the trapping and hunting of the falcon. At the same time, working in collaboration with a number of other organizations, she established the Friends of the Amur Falcon campaign, an awareness program that is seeing effects across the community. Trailblazing, collaborative, she is a woman that we all admire. And for this, we honor Bano Haralu. May I request Mr. Satish Mathur, Wildlifer to the Corps, Director General of Police, Maharashtra, the head of the State Tiger Cell, to please join us on stage to present this award.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you, Sanctuary, for this recognition and this honor. But I would like to share this moment by remembering several people who have been key to my work in Nagaland. My late mother, who was my fan and my hero, Mom, you truly were the wind beneath my wings. I also especially remember my colleagues and friends, Rokohebi Kotsu, Ramki Srinivasan, and Shashank Dalvi, without whom the race to save the Amur Falcons might have turned out differently. I am often asked if there was a single factor that contributed to be a game changer in the fate of these migratory birds. I still don't have the answer. But I do know that there was no single factor. It was the orchestration of countless movements, movements that ranged from the response of a hunting community for whom conservation was a very new practice, and who rose to the challenge of practicing conservation of the Amur Falcons. And then again, to the immediate response of the NGOs, such as the Raptor Research Conservation Foundation, the Bombay Natural History Society, the Wildlife Conservation Society, and the Wildlife Conservation Trust. I thank you all from the bottom of our hearts for having engaged in Nagaland, which hitherto was not a place where most wildlife organizations would venture into because of the infamous name of Nagaland as rampant for hunting. But I think that is all changing now. Nagaland is now declared the falcon capital of the world. Without your generous support, it would have been impossible for us to carry on working amidst our communities. And finally, to the chief musician, the conductor of all things of creation seen and unseen, I draw my inspiration from the psalmist who said, I look at the heavens and see your creation and look at the works of your fingers, the moon and the stars that you have put in place. What is man that you are mindful of him? The son of man that you care for him. You made him a little lower than the heavenly beings and crowned him with glory and honor. You made him ruler over the works of your hands. You put everything under his feet and flocks, all flocks of herds and the beasts of the field, the birds of the air and the fish of the sea. All that swim the path of the seas. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. Thank you.
The Sanctuary Lifetime Service Award is conferred each year on an individual who has spent his or her life in the defense of wild nature. A man of old world values, integrity, honesty, hard work, and compassion. In the Palamo Tiger Reserve in Jharkhand, this IFS officer cracked down on the Katha Mafia, taking on smugglers and poacher gangs. He fought proponents of the Kutku Dam with help from affected villagers and even convinced the army that their proposed firing range would harm Palamo, not help India. His love for wild nature was so transparent and matched by his love of communities that unknown to him, the Maoists granted him abhaydan, or safe passage through all rebel-controlled areas. In the Hazaribagh Wildlife Sanctuary in 1998, he locked horns with the coal mafia and convinced the Indian Railways to realign their track to save the sanctuary. Posted back to his beloved Palamo in 2011 as field director, he whipped the crumbling park back into shape. He led by example, repairing broken infrastructure, resurrecting wireless networks, and walking for miles through the reserve. Under his guidance, his staff undertook a camera trapping exercise that yielded images of not just tigers, the first seen in 15 years, but other wildlife long thought to have gone locally extinct. In this time, he had numerous run-ins with the security apparatus of the state, standing up to them when they manhandled his men and refusing to give them access to reserve infrastructure because such a move would shatter the unofficial truce between the rebels and his forest staff and could invite retaliatory fire. In every member of the Indian Forest Service, if every member of the Indian Forest Service had even a fraction of this legend's grit, gumption, and grace, India would never have to worry about its wilds. He is a hero for the ages. And for this, we honor S.E.H. Kasmi. May I request Mr. Hemendra Kothari, Chairman DSP Black Talks, founder of the Wildlife Conservation Trust and a true champion, as you all know, for conservation, to please come on stage and present the Sanctuary Lifetime Service Award. Ladies and gentlemen, let's celebrate the work of Mr. S.E.H. Kasmi. Thank you, Mr. Kothari.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you, Sanctuary, especially Bittu, for bestowing me with this prestigious award. Before I begin, I must put in two disclaimers. First is that I have never been on such a distinguished public platform, nor have ever been under such limelight, so this all is very new and unique to me. My work is always done far away from public eye, and to be honest, I really liked it that way, for it gave me the freedom to do things in a certain way. Since textbook management and prescribed guidelines don't really work in an insurgency-affected area. And that brings me to my second disclaimer. Wherever I went, my work was never my work alone per se. It was the work of my entire team, especially my field staff. No achievement that is attributed to me could have been realized without the we behind it, which consisted of my daily wage trackers, informers, forest guards, foresters, range officers, ACFs, supportive seniors such as Mr. P.K. Sen and Mr. P.R. Sinha, as well as the warm support and goodwill of local people. And so even if I am the face in front of you receiving this award, I want to make it clear that I humbly receive it on behalf of those hundreds of nameless and faceless heroes back home in Jharkhand. the Forest Department, being the official custodian of nearly 30% of our landmass, deserves to be given greater importance by the government. It needs to invest more in the department, especially in recruitment of field staff and according them the respect and facilities they deserve. Also, more good people must join the government services and try to fix its defects from within. At the same time, society needs to recognize the immense sacrifices made by our field staff and honor them the way we honor our armed forces. Because if the army jawan guards the frontiers, the field staff guards the country's most precious resource, forests and wildlife. I must also talk here about our tribals and other forest dwellers. I have been fortunate enough to have been welcomed into the life and world of these incredible people. My experience tells me that exclusionist policies may win you some gains in small limited patches of forest for a short term, but without their support and cooperation, you will always lose in the long run on a landscape level. Mother Earth cannot be saved in perpetuity by alienating the children who have the most intimate connection with it. That is what I tried doing throughout my career as an officer, doing things that benefited both conservation and people. Finally, I have some advice for all. Always treat forest communities with respect, dignity, and politeness. Be honest and truthful with them. Hear out their problems and grievances patiently. Work as diligently towards solving them as you would towards protecting wildlife. Be gentle with them, but never patronizing, because they know and understand the forest far better than us. Respect their culture and way of life. Never forget that it is they who have made the greatest sacrifice for conservation. None of us sitting here will sacrifice our homes, fields, and lands for the cause. It is they who have done so and will continue doing so. And that is debt which we can never repay. We need to stand with the locals against common adversaries, the entities which wish to exploit and finally destroy the natural world. Nature conservation is not something which is only the domain of one department or one set of people. So all of us must work collectively. On a parting note, in 1984, when I was a struggling and frustrated, unemployed young man who had failed in the IFS exam twice with only one last attempt to go, I had picked up an issue of Sanctuary, noted down the address of late Kailash Sakla Sahab, and cycled up to his house. It was his words of encouragement that played a huge role in motivating me to clear the exam. And here I am today, standing amidst the Sanctuary family at their award ceremony 32 years later. Life indeed has come a full circle. Thank you.
आप असल के हीरो हो भाई. I've known you for so long. Every single day, you inspire me more and more and more. You are the kind of person I would like our children to look up to and want to be like you. Friends, it's been a slightly longer ceremony than normal, It's come to a close. Praveen Pardeshi has been, like Mr. Kazmi, using the system to make sure that the right thing is done the right way. Like the diversity of a forest, we need diverse methods to protect the forest. And Praveen, I owe you a debt of gratitude. I really owe you a debt of gratitude, not because of what you've done for Maharashtra, but the way you've taught us to use the system. And look at what Kazmi Saab has just said within the system. This evening, we've revisited India's awe-inspiring wilds, celebrated the work of some very special people. But before our guardians of tomorrow return to the stage so that we can give them one last standing ovation, I want each of you to actually fish into your goodie bags, pull out that copy of Sanctuary magazine, if you will. Can we have the house lights on? To it is attached a card on which you can pledge your support for the Sanctuary Nature Foundation. Each of you, by your presence in this auditorium, is a card-carrying member of the foundation. Literally, figuratively, everything. And every contribution, big or small, will be cherished and put towards the protection of India. When you exit, you can drop a half of your pledge card. There's a sanctuary card down there. There's a table down there. You can do that. But yes, all the ATGs and all that, we managed to get it done. Nick, what a wonderful group of people these are. May I ask you, Kazmi Saab, to please come back and lead your heroes back into one